अभी तो असली मंजिल पाना बाकी है, अभी तो इरादों का इम्तिहान बाकी है, अभी तो तोली है मुट्ठी भर ज़मीन, अभी तो तोलना आसमान बाकी है। हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू M10 क्लासेस। टुडे यू आर गोइंग टू रीड अबाउट न्यूट्रिशन इन अमीबा एंड इन ह्यूमन बींग्स। इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी आर ऑलरेडी रीड अबाउट ऑटोट्रॉपिक न्यूट्रिशन इन प्लांट्स एंड सम बेसिक्स अबाउट हेटरोट्रॉपिक न्यूट्रिशन। सो लेट अस सी टुडेज टॉपिक न्यूट्रिशन इन अमीबा इन एंड इन ह्यूमन बींग्स। सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल द व्हाट इज द स्पेशलिटी ऑफ अमीबा। अमीबा इज एन यूनिसेलुलर ऑर्गेनिज्म व्हिच कैन चेंज इट्स बॉडी शेप। एज वी हैव ऑलरेडी रेड, इट हैज होलोजोइक मोड ऑफ न्यूट्रिशन, दैट मीन्स इट इज गोइंग टू एनगल्फ द फूड एंड इट हैज अ स्पेशल प्रोसेस दैट इज फैगोसाइटोसिस टू एनगल्फ द फूड। एज यू कैन सी इन द फिगर, whenever a food particle it comes near amoeba it forms pseudopodia. What is pseudopodia? pseudo means false and podia means feet. So it is false feet created by amoeba to which surrounds the food particle and gradually it forms food vacuole. This food vacuole enters into the cytoplasm of amoeba where the digestion of the food takes place, then absorption and assimilation takes place. After the assimilation takes place, you have waste material formed in the body of amoeba which gets excreted out by the process of exocytosis as seen in the figure. Now let us watch a video for the formation of pseudopodia by amoeba. Now students, see in the figure. Now students, you can see here the food particles is coming near amoeba and it takes out the projection from its body which forms pseudopodia and it covers it and gradually it will form the food vacuole. Now see, it has surrounded the food particle, it is a paramecium which it has already engulfed and it will form food vacuole into the body and then it is going to digest it inside the cytoplasm of amoeba. Now students, there is a question for you. Name the cell of human body which can change its shape. As you have already seen, amoeba is changing its shape. Like this, there is a cell in her body which can change its shape. So what would be the answer? So right, it would be WBC, and WBC can change its shape. Now let us come to paramecium. So paramecium, as you know, it is also an unicellular organism and it also has holozoic mode of nutrition. But unlike paramecium, it cannot change its shape. So how do you think it collects the food and engulfs it? So paramecium has tiny hair-like structures all over its body which is known as cilia. With the help of cilia, paramecium moves the food particle to a particular spot on its body which is known as cytostome where it engulfs the food. You can see it in the figure. So before going to start human digestive system or nutrition in human beings, so we must see human alimentary canal through which this digestion takes place. The food passes through the alimentary canal, digestion, absorption, assimilation and excretion takes place. The food enters through the mouth or the buccal cavity, then it passes through oesophagus, then comes to stomach, then it will pass to small intestine. And before going to small intestine, at the junction, the secretions of liver and pancreas, it mixes with the food from the stomach and it enters in the small intestine. In your small intestine, complete digestion of food takes place along with absorption. So what remains is your undigested food which passes through the large intestine. And finally, the undigested food, it comes out of your body through anus. So we'll read in details. So students, in this video I have written all the details of this human digestive system and you can make notes out of it. It will be easier for you to read and remember. Now let us see human digestive system or nutrition in human beings. As we have already read that human beings have holistic mode of nutrition. Food passes through the different parts of alimentary canal where it is digested. So we'll see the total parts from the process of ingestion to the process of excretion. Now the process of ingestion starts from your mouth, that is your buccal cavity. So what are the things that happens in your buccal cavity? So what are the different parts of buccal cavity? The first one is teeth. So the teeth is used to chew the food. So what happens? This chewing is nothing but to grind the food. While you grind the food particles become smaller, which increases the surface area for the action of digestive enzymes. Now consider you take a large log of wood and try to burn it. Obviously, it is going to take a lot of time. Now you cut it into smaller pieces, then burn it, and it will burn rapidly. That means as the area, surface area for the action of the fire increases, it burns rapidly. Likewise, after when the surface area of the food after grinding increases, the digestive enzymes, they also work faster. Then comes your tongue. Tongue helps in mixing the food. You know that tongue helps to detect the taste of the food because it has taste buds on it. It mixes the saliva with the food and makes bolus. Bolus is a mixture of the saliva and the food, which makes it into a mass, which becomes easier for it to passing through alimentary canal. Then comes your salivary gland. Salivary, you have three pairs, that means six salivary glands in your body, and these are present between the buccal cavity and your ear. These are namely parotid, submandibular, and sublingual, though these are not important from your exam point of view. This is for some extra facts that you need to know. So what is the function of the salivary gland? It secretes saliva. In a day, you'll be astonished to know that around 0.5 to 1.5 liter of saliva is secreted from the salivary gland. What is the function of the saliva? Saliva has an enzyme which is called salivary amylase or tylin, which helps in digestion of starch and for breaking it down into sugar. Now there is a question for you, why do you brush every morning? So students, in your teeth you have enamel, which is the hardest substance of your body. It doesn't corrode in water. But when you eat food and some food is remaining in your mouth, and this food is gradually decomposed, and the sugar is decomposed to form acids, and the enamel is decayed in acid, and that is why we need to brush every morning. When you brush, the toothpaste is basic and which neutralizes the acidity present in your mouth, and that's by this it protects the teeth from decaying. Now let us come to the next part, that is oesophagus or food pipe. So it doesn't have a particular function, but yes, it helps in passing the food through the next part of the digestive system. Now there is a specific moment that is called peristalsis or peristaltic moment. You might have seen when a snake engulfs a frog into its body, it gradually flows into the body as shown in the figure here. See, likewise, our wall of the oesophagus, it contracts and relaxes rhythmically to produce a downward motion for the food that we eat, and that is called peristalsis. It doesn't only occur at oesophagus, but through all the parts of the alimentary canal, and it helps to pass the food. Next come to an important part of your body, that is your stomach. Your stomach contains gastric gland, which secretes gastric juice. Now this gastric juice has three components. What are the three components? First one is hydrochloric acid. You know that hydrochloric acid is a strong acid. It is produced from the gastric glands inside the stomach. First of all, its function is to provide acidic medium for the action of pepsin. We are going to read about pepsin. Secondly, it kills the foreign organisms like bacteria and viruses and helps to prevent any kind of infections. Next comes pepsin. Pepsin is a digestive enzyme which breaks down the protein. The digestion of protein takes place from stomach. Then is mucus. Mucus protects the inner lining of the stomach from HCl. So you know that HCl is a strong acid. If it you are going to put it on your skin, it is going to burn. So inside the stomach also, it can also burn the inner lining of the stomach. And mucus protects the inner lining of the stomach from getting affected from this HCl or hydrochloric acid. So you might have heard about peptic ulcer or simply ulcer in your stomach. So what happens, suppose you do not take food properly when you feel hungry, then what happens, the hydrochloric acid produced in your body when it is not neutralized from getting any kind of food, it gradually affects the inner lining of the stomach, and by this process it affects the inner lining of the stomach and ulcer is produced. So students, eat properly, eat regularly and at proper time. Then in your stomach, this partially digested food gradually enters into the small intestine through a sphincter muscle that is called your pyloric sphincter. The sphincter muscles are nothing but like a valve. Okay, through this valve, you are going to push the food gradually into the small intestine. Now, when the food gradually passes from stomach to the small intestine, now there are two bodyguards which are watching over it. What are they? They are liver and pancreas. Let us first come to liver. Liver is the largest gland of your human body. This is a fact that you must know. Now, how does it help in the process of digestion? It secretes bile juice and bile salt. Now, the food comes from the stomach, which is acidic. But pancreas, which is going to release some digestive enzymes, they need alkaline medium for the action of the enzymes. So this bile juice makes the food alkaline for the action of pancreatic enzymes. Now, bile salt. Bile salt is used for the emulsification of fat. So what is emulsification? Breaking down of the larger fat globules into the smaller fat globules. That is called your emulsification. Now then comes pancreas. Students, there is a fact about pancreas that it is both endocrine and exocrine gland. And if you don't know what is endocrine and exocrine, we are going to read it in the latter parts in this class 10 only. So what are the components of pancreatic juice? Pancreatic juice contains pancreatic amylase, trypsin and lipase. So as you can see, the names are similar, like your salivary amylase, and here you have pancreatic amylase. So salivary amylase was digesting starch. Here also pancreatic amylase helps in breaking down of carbohydrate. Trypsin, like pepsin in your stomach, helps in breaking down of protein, and lipase, it helps in breaking down of fat. Now the partially digested food and the secretions from liver and pancreas enter into the duodenum of small intestine, where further digestion takes place. Now let us come to the next part of the alimentary canal, that is your small intestine. You have already read that small intestine is coiled and it is the longest part of the human body, and its length varies from 5 to 7 meter like this. It has three parts: duodenum, jejunum and ileum. So what is the importance of small intestine in the process of digestion? It is the site of complete digestion of food. Secondly, it absorbs the digested food into the bloodstream. So these are very important functions of small intestine. First of all, the complete digestion of food. That means the food completely gets broken down into simpler substances, and as it has already been converted into simpler substances, it becomes easier to be absorbed by the bloodstream. This small intestine contains numerous finger-like projections called villi, which increases the surface area for absorption and helps in the movement of the food through small intestine. Now this is the figure of villi. Now this villi contains blood vessels and helps in absorption of the digested food to get into the bloodstream. Okay, as you know, the process after the process of digestion, you have the process of absorption, then comes assimilation. When this simpler substances are getting absorbed into the bloodstream, through the bloodstream it will reach the different parts of the body, which helps in the growth of the body and also repairing and other activities that the cell carries out. Next, what are the end products of complete digestion? So as in the small intestine complete digestion takes place, it is getting converted into very simpler substances. That is, the carbohydrate is breaking its simplest substance is glucose. Protein is digested into amino acid, and fats into fatty acid and glycerol. These substances are getting absorbed into the bloodstream. Then coming to the last part, that is your large intestine. As you have seen, ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation is complete. The last part is excretion. So the undigested food from the small intestine, it enters into the large intestine. In this large intestine, villi are also present, but its function is to absorb water from the undigested food. And finally, the undigested food, it comes out of the anus through a sphincter muscle, and where the excretion completes. Now this completes the total process of nutrition in human digestive system. Now in the next class, we are going to read about a new topic related to biology of the same chapter. Till then, keep in touch, see the videos and learn from the videos. Thank you. I beg your pardon, before winding up, I had a question for you. That is, cow has longer small intestine than tiger. Why? Now see, I have already told you that the kind of digestive system or the process of nutrition, it depends upon the complexity of the food that you intake. In case of tiger, it is carnivorous, and it basically eats flesh, and flesh is normally protein which can be digested easily. But cow, it is herbivorous, and it takes only plant products like your leaves, and the plant products contain cellulose, and cellulose takes a lot of time to get digested, and that is why cow has longer small intestine than tiger. Okay, students, this is all for today. We'll meet in the next class. Till then, bye bye.